Good morning. Thank you, Alexei, for your introduction. I already introduced myself briefly on Monday. As some of you know, I started my academic career here in Kharkiv. I studied at Karazin Kharkiv National University. And now I'm based in Vienna, partly affiliated to the University of Vienna, Department of Political Science, and partly I'm working for the Institute for Human Sciences, which is an independent institution doing research and inviting, visiting scholars from Europe and not only from Europe. And I'm in charge of the Ukraine and Russia programs in this institute. So this is probably what you should know about who I am. We will talk more about my research projects next week, and I will try to share with you my approach, my methodology, my outcomes of my research. What I'm going to do today is to give you more like a brief overview of who, how, and with what purpose is using the Borderlands discourse in post-Soviet Ukraine, and also to, I will try to contextualize this talk about Borderlands. We are talking about Borderlands already for 5 days, yeah? And my idea is to bring us somehow back to Ukraine and to see what Borderlands, who is talking about Borderlands, who is imagining Ukrainian regions as borderland regions, and why, and with what political purposes, with what political projects behind it. So I will mainly focus on Lviv and Kharkiv because I did my research in these two cities. And of course, you can always interrupt me and ask questions, and if you need a clarification or explanation, you are welcome. I will start with like more general observations which are relevant for the whole post-Soviet era. But in the end of my talk, I will try to reconsider some of my assumptions in the new political context of the current Ukrainian-Russian conflict, which of course has changed the the premises of this discussion. So let us start. This is more or less how we are going to proceed today. So as you probably noticed, one can hardly ignore the popularity of the Borderlands discourse and Borderlands concept and proliferation of Borderlands discourses in academic, cultural, and political contexts, and especially in Eastern Europe, in East Central Europe. Our school is not an exception. It's just one example of this growing interest to the Borderlands. And let me just start with three points, three reasons why I think we witness this growing interest to the Borderlands and this kind of proliferation of the Borderlands discourses. So the first reason for me seems to be the end of the Cold War. The end of the Cold War dramatically changed the role and geopolitical status of borders and border regions in Europe. And the old understanding of borderlands as a frontier, as a buffer zone, sanitarny cordon, no man's land, ничейная земля, has been replaced by the new vision of borderlands as a contact zone, a system of communication, and a social network. And we can observe this actually everywhere in the post-Cold War Europe, but especially in Eastern Europe, where the cross-border cooperation has become an instrument of the European integration. But even if we look at the Schengen border, at the external border of the European Union, despite policies of strict control and surveillance, this border has been legitimized by such values as mutual interest, cooperation, and transfer of European norms. So think about these concepts like European neighborhood, ring of friends. The names of these concepts alone, they refer to communication, friendly relations, and of course also the idea of the European neighborhood program has been to soften the hard effects of the EU's external border regime, compensating for social alienation and political isolation in the neighborhood of the EU as the side effects of the rebordering of the European Union. So in other words, even when constructing new borders and primarily barrier functions of these borders, political actors frame it in the liberal rhetoric of borderlands. The second reason is that in the globalized world, border regions in Eastern Europe, which, as we know, had suffered most from the two world wars, from local conflicts, ethnic cleansings, ethnic conflicts, are paradoxically reimagined today as nostalgic spaces for true multiculturalism, cultural authenticity, and traditions rooted deep in history. This idealized cultural diversity of the old empires becomes a synonym for desired Europeanness, that is believed to be found on the periphery. So Ukrainians probably know, not probably, but certainly know Yuri Andruhovich, a well-known Ukrainian writer who kind of developed his own mythology of this multicultural periphery as a kind of nostalgic space. I will talk later about it. So the kind of Europe that is evoked here in this discourse is the world before nationalisms and national boundaries. And this world is projected into the future, a multicultural Europe without borders, a kind of utopia that the European Union kind of has been drawing its energy from. And we can, of course, talk especially now about the limits of this utopia. But this is certainly true that this reference to multicultural Europe without borders is a kind of important idea. And Pamela Ballinger, who is an American anthropologist, she studied Istrian borderlands. She wrote about imperial nostalgia in the case of Trieste, which is now an Italian city, but used to be a Habsburgian city, and actually I am going to talk about it and to compare Trieste with Lviv later next week. But she studied this kind of imperial nostalgia in the case of Trieste, and she noticed that the myth of a cosmopolitan past reflects our own contemporary concern with multicultural societies and cosmopolitanism. The same is true for Ukrainian Lviv. And so on the one hand, in contemporary Europe, borderlands appear as particularly victim-intensive places. Think about Timothy Snyder's Bloodlands. On the other hand, borderlands are imagined today as fragments of the old world before nationalism, and nostalgic tourism turns borderlands into open-air museums of an authentic multicultural Europe. And finally, the third reason for the popularity of the borderlands concept is the regionalization of Europe and the increased political autonomy of border regions. It was already from the late 80s, 1980s, from the late 1980s on, that the power of a centralized state was eroded by globalization and transnationalization processes and by European integration. And increased mobility of capital and the rise of transnational corporations. And the state partly gave up its ambitions to develop the national peripheries. Market liberalization now requires new forms of competitiveness based on innovation, networking, and quality of human capital. And border regions, they often lack modern industrial infrastructure, or sometimes they possess a hopelessly outdated infrastructure. They are encouraged to make use of their local cultural resources. And for the tourist branch, borderlands becomes an attractive brand which promises tourist clients enjoying two or more cultures at the same time, experiencing two or more languages, enjoying different cuisines. So this kind of development in the European Union can count on financial support for the border EU border regions, which also encourages them to develop cross-border projects and support like local transnational borderland identities. Before I turn to Ukraine, I would like to acknowledge the work of the Polish sociologist Tomasz Zarycki. Some of you probably know his work. So his book, Ideologies of Eastness in Central and Eastern Europe, was published some years ago by Routledge. And Zarycki was one of the first to approach critically this new popular discourse of borderlands, and I suggested a chapter from his book. You can look into it, or maybe you had a chance to look into it already. And actually his writing kind of inspired me to consider also the uses of the borderland discourses in Ukraine. So Zarycki points to the fact that the new paradigm of borderlands tends to ignore power relations and the center-periphery hierarchy. And borderlands are presented as a free land where traditions of various cultures meet and subjects have freedom to choose identity. He says, in contrast to the old discourse of frontier, and in the Polish case this is Eastern Kresy Wschodnie, which has been exclusive, conflict-ridden and nationalist, the new Borderlands discourse is liberal and post-colonial. It opposes cultural homogenization and assimilation. But at the same time, conceptualizing the region in terms of borderlands, ascribing it multiculturality, diversity, and hybridity often leads to kind of orientalization and exotization of the region. And this discourse, according to Zhurzhenko, plays a compensatory role as it promises symbolic and moral advantages in kind of in compensation for geographic and economic marginality. And according to Zhurzhenko, this is first of all the provincial intelligentsia which produces borderlands discourse and gets symbolic profits from it. Now turning to Ukraine, as you probably have noticed already, there's hardly any book on Ukrainian history, especially in Western historiography, which does not start with the notion of Ukraine as borderlands. Ukraina literally means borderlands. And Ukraine is attractive to historians because exactly because of this kind of borderland situation and transnational influences. So it's a sort of laboratory, and there is even a book published by Philippe, I think, and Kasyanov, Laboratory of Transnational History. But I'm not a historian, and I'm rather a political scientist, so I'm interested in another aspect of this Ukraine as borderlands paradigm, namely political and geopolitical. And I think that unfinished transition from the Soviet system to the Western type of democracy has been reconceptualized in our region as new borderlands. We are talking about new Eastern Europe, new borderlands of Europe. So it's a borderlands between the enlarged EU, which stopped at the, with the exception of the Baltic states, at the former western border of the Soviet Union, and post-Soviet Russia. So it's borderlands between the EU and Russia. And already after the Orange Revolution, it became clear that Ukraine is not going to join the EU and even NATO in the midterm future. And a part of Ukrainian society, growing part of the Ukrainian society and political class, perceived this situation as a geopolitical marginalization, exclusion, or even isolation from Europe, bearing the risk of increased political and economic dependency on Russia. This was before the events of 2014. And now, of course, we have even more reasons of thinking in these terms. So from this perspective, unfinished nation building perpetuates Ukraine's borderland status. But what I want to argue in my talk is that these tendencies are experienced and perceived differently in different parts of Ukraine. If in the West, in Western Ukraine, the feeling of marginality is very much related to this failed EU membership aspirations and the new Schengen border, in the East, it is caused by disintegration of the Soviet Empire. At the same time, the local elites from the Ukrainian border regions have to cope with their own marginalized position in the new system of center-periphery relations, like Kharkiv, which was somehow part of the imperial Soviet core, imperial Soviet heartlands, became a borderland city, and this is a kind of the need for reconceptualizing its status, its identity, as something which concerned very much the local elites. So therefore, I decided to compare two border regions, two border cities, in terms of political uses of the borderland discourse, in order to see how the respective regional elites, intellectual as well as political, make sense of their borderland situations. And as I said, these are two regions and two cities, Lviv and Kharkiv. And they differ, of course, not only in the geopolitical location, but also in their historical background, cultural identity, and political mentality. So speaking about Lviv, it's actually an important place in Ukraine where multiple discourses and multiple perspectives on borderlands cross. And for sure you can find in Lviv what Tomasz Zarycki calls the old frontier discourse. It emphasizes the Ukrainian identity of Lviv and Galicia, Galicina, which is presented from a kind of teleological perspective as a deeply rooted in history, and at the same time resulting from a centuries-long national liberation struggle. The two powerful narratives that constitute this discourse is the November uprising of 1918, which gave Ukrainians brief control over Lviv and started the Ukrainian-Polish War of 1918. And second, the heroic struggle of the Ukrainian insurgent army, Ukrainska Povstanska Armia. So what you can see here is a tourist guide for Lviv, which presents this Lviv, Mista Nashi Heroiv, Lviv, a city of our heroes, which presents this kind of discourse of Ukrainian Lviv, and it's mainly kind of mapping interwar Lviv as a place where Ukrainian underground fought for against Polish occupation. And the narrative is of course of heroic sacrifice and suffering of one particular ethnic group, namely Ukrainians. So this Ukrainian frontier discourse is nationalist and exclusive as its Polish counterpart, the discourse of Kresy Wschodnie, but the Ukrainian one is rather affirmative than nostalgic. So if if Polish discourse is about mourning the victims and nostalgia for the Polish Lviv, the Ukrainian one is very much about present Lviv, whose Ukrainian identity is still under threat, and especially it was during Kuchma and Yanukovych presidency that this threat was perceived as coming from the pro-Russian Kyiv, Kyiv being like under control of the pro-Russian forces. And with Russia partly replacing Poland as a historical enemy. So when I was doing my research in Lviv, this was partly already beginning of the Yanukovych era, and this was very much like this feeling that Lviv is again endangered, the Ukrainian identity of Lviv is endangered from Kyiv. Here again, some examples how this frontier discourses, Ukrainian frontier discourses, are presented in Lviv. The monument to Danilo Halitsky, the king who founded Lviv, and the historical reconstruction or reenactment of the November uprising in Lviv. On November 1st, you see this scene in front of the city council in Vienna. At the same time, the new borderlands discourse has been promoted by the Lviv liberal intelligentsia, which is critical to ethnic nationalism and exclusionism. And this idea of borderlands promoted by this liberal intelligentsia is related first to multiculturalism and second to Europe and EU integration. Contrary to the nationalist frontier discourse, this borderlands discourse is open and inclusive, and it recognizes the Polish and Jewish heritage of Lviv and Galicia and deplores the lost cultural diversity, does not mourn only Ukrainian victims. Something I also wanted to show in relation to this competing nationalist discourses of frontier, the commemoration of November 1st by Polish community in Lviv and by Ukrainians. But back to the borderlands, liberal borderlands discourse, it's difficult to overestimate the role of some Lviv institutions and intellectuals, and to name only some of them, this is the Ukrainian Catholic University, Institute for Urban History, cultural magazine Yi, I don't know if it still exists, but it was very important in the first two decades of the Ukrainian independence. Due to the efforts of these institutions and people connected to them, some new inclusive commemorative projects emerged in Lviv, and among them there is a new initiative aimed at increasing visibility of the Jewish memory in Lviv and the memory of the Holocaust. Anna Chebatarova can certainly tell more about this. There is also a joint Polish-Ukrainian monument to the Polish university professors executed by the Nazis in 1949. So there is this attempt coming from the local intellectuals and local civil society to offer an alternative to more like nationalist discourse of the Ukrainian frontier in Lviv. This liberal milieu is often attacked by the nationalists. They still operate with the old paradigm of borderlands as contested lands and threatened territory, which has to be renationalized and whose Ukrainian identity needs to be protected. This concept of borderlands, which appears in the discourse of the liberal intelligentsia, is postmodern and postcolonial. Borderlands are not conceived as a province, but as a cultural center, cultural capital. So Lviv sees itself not as a periphery, but culturally as a capital of Ukraine, and it is strong discourse of being, like, in terms of culture, being a competitor to Kyiv. And thus, borderlands is a site where cultures, identities, languages meet and enrich each other. And that is why Lviv, which is rather marginal in terms of economic wealth and political influence, can compete with a national capital in cultural affairs. And at the same time, it's interesting that most protagonists of this discourse question the concept of multiculturalism and doubt the future of multiculturalism. And of course, they are informed about the current Western debates about the failure of multiculturalism. And rather pessimistic as far as real multiculturalism in Lviv is concerned. For example, Irina Magdish, one of the Lviv intellectuals related to the cultural magazine Yi, admitted once that multicultural Lviv belongs to the past and cannot be revitalized. Instead, its citizens should try to make Lviv a city of modern Ukrainian culture, including, in the best case, elements of other cultures and traditions. Not for multiculturalism should we fight, she says, but against the lack of culture. And similar motives can be found also in the writings of Yuri Andruhovich, who I already mentioned, a prominent Ukrainian writer who created his personal mythology of Lviv and Galicia as a nostalgic Habsburgian, originally European, multicultural, authentic, exotic space. So at the same time, he ironically distances himself from such constructions, saying that Galicia, according to him, does not exist. It's a fragment of imagination. Also, Yaroslav Hritsak, a prominent Lviv historian, writes about the Borderlands subject as a person who permanently faces the choice of identity, and at the same time he often criticizes conformism as a characteristic feature of Galician mentality. So we see that this liberal discourse is self-reflective and self-ironic, trying to deconstruct, so to say, its own construct, the Galician identity. And at the same time, so you can see here some images referring to this kind of policy of revitalizing multicultural Lviv. At the same time, we can speak about the construct of Europe as another key element of the Borderlands discourse. And here again, liberal intellectuals present Lviv as a modern European city in Ukraine, a city with a geopolitical mission to bring Ukraine to the European Union. Taras Vozniak, the editor of the magazine Yi and also a member of the city council, wrote once that Lviv finds itself at the front line of the EU integration processes in Ukraine. From this perspective, Galicia is not a buffer zone, but a stronghold of Europe in Ukraine. It is already Europe, if still only potential. Projecting this understanding of Europe on the rest of the country, Andruhovich wrote during the Orange Revolution that without Ukraine, Europe is incomplete. And even if this kind of idealism is faded away, in the eyes of many Lviv's intellectuals, Europe is still incomplete without Galicia and without Lviv. And of course, as a city so close to Europe and being almost a Europe itself, no wonder that Lviv inhabitants were particularly frustrated with the political developments of the last decade, which ultimately left Ukraine outside of the EU borders. And in geopolitical terms, the idea of borderlands is in Europe turns out to be productive and promising, but at the same time as a kind of source of frustration and discouragement at the same time, because it's a kind of promise of Europe which can never be fulfilled in this kind of utopian sense. So similar to the nationalist frontier discourse, the liberal borderlands discourse is also anti-communist and anti-Soviet, but it tends to avoid the competition of victims, competition, so to say, of victimized groups fighting for their right to commemorate their suffering. So this liberal discourse tries to avoid memory wars by presenting the Borderlands as a collective victim of, in this case, of the Hitler and Stalin aggressions and mass repressions. So, for example, in 2010, when I was in Lviv, there was an exhibition under the title Lviv in 1939-1941, which was opened at the city central square Rynek, and it was a joint Polish-Ukrainian initiative, and the idea was very much about reconciling different narratives of suffering constructed along ethnic lines and present some kind of construct, kind of collective subject of suffering, Lviv. This new liberal politics of reconciliation draws on the narrative of common suffering, which presents all ethnic groups in the city, Ukrainians, Poles, Jews, as victims of two totalitarian regimes. And here you see the cover of the Yi journal, which kind of illustrates this discourse. And united in this victimhood, they are supposed, various groups are supposed to forget about their mutual animosities, the hostilities, and also about their own collective guilt. So here I focused now on the intellectual elites in Lviv, and I will be also very brief on the role of the local political elites in the production and instrumentalization of the Borderlands discourses. So in short, the ruling elites in the region have been making use of both discourses depending on the situation and audience. Lviv's mayor, Andriy Sadovy, presented himself as quite receptive to the ideas of multiculturalism, cross-border cooperation, and reconciliation with the Polish neighbors. And of course, the municipal authorities tried to present the city as modern, I don't know if you can go back, yeah, as modern, multicultural, open, inclusive city. A city open to the world is a kind of motto of the city council. At the same time, the municipal authorities, they are also under growing pressure from the right-wing and nationalist groups, and they present themselves to the local public as true Ukrainian patriots. So the Lviv municipality have been restoring numerous graves and memorial sites dedicated to the Ukrainian insurgent army and Ukrainian Galician army. And the Lviv Regional Assembly is even more populist and nationalist in this respect, operating often with old images of contested borderlands and being constantly engaged in disputes with the Polish neighbors on memory and history. So this was Lviv. You can see here the monument to Stepan Bandera and the official motto of the Lviv municipality, open to the world. Now, moving to eastern borderlands, to the Ukrainian-Russian borderlands, to Kharkiv. this photo is meant as a kind of provocative illustration for this feeling of ambivalence and unfinished process of rebordering the post-Soviet space. It was taken, I don't know, I think already 15 years ago in the Belarusian city Gomel, where there was a festival of Slavic cultures, actually bringing together people from Russia, Ukraine, Belarus, and celebrating kind of common cultural origins. And here you can see it's a, So what do you see here? What do you think? What is it? What is it supposed to illustrate? This is the border post with Ukrainian and Russian flags on it, so two national symbols. So this is the symbol of separation of two brotherly nations. You can read Druzhba in the background, yeah? And you can see a these are pigs. So if we would have Mykola Rybczuk here, he would say this is a perfect illustration for this kind of colonial representation of Ukraine. So this is a Ukrainian Cossack, I don't know, dressed in ethnic Ukrainian clothes, as they were also known in the Soviet Union as part of the kind of ethnic Ukrainian culture. And he's, instead of, this is the border post, so it's a kind of borderland situation, but instead of border dogs, he has border pigs. And pigs are like, animals, like Germans have this kind of very intimate relation to pigs, so Ukrainians have tools. They like salo, and salo again is something, it's a kind of subject of many kind of jokes and anecdotes about ethnic Ukrainians. So, basically, this photo I use it to illustrate my book, which I published in 2010, and I would never do it now. But at that time, it looked for me like it's a perfect illustration for this ambivalent borderland situation, which is in the Ukrainian-Russian borderlands, which is still like not perceived as a real border, or it has been changing since 2014. But before, this was kind of border which, in symbolic terms, was not perceived as a real international border.
Can I ask you for a short question? To me, on the border sign, it's not the right version of Russian flag. Like, it's blue, white, and red. Not correct. And the second one, I mean, do these pigs were decorated by Russian Ukrainian flag, or it's kind of mistake? Because on the right one, I can see blue and yellow, and on the left right is definitely red and white, or maybe green or something.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of strange to create pigs with flags in
Why not?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it was a subversive message in it. But I think it was just, I don't know. So I thank you for pointing to this. And I think the pigs are just decorated with so it has no political meaning, the choice of colors. Yeah, so if in Lviv the discourse of borderlands has emerged as emancipating, positive, and productive, as anti-Soviet and pro-European at the same time, in Kharkiv, in the east of Ukraine, The Borderlands discourse has been first of all connected to the trauma of disintegration of the Soviet Union. And the response to the new Borderlands situation, kind of unexpected geopolitical reality, which emerged overnight with the collapse of the Soviet Union in the 90s, was kind of very much frustration, pessimism, and nostalgia. And the collapse of the Soviet Union marginalized Kharkiv in a different way than Lviv. Kharkiv's new marginality did not bring it closer to Europe, or at least imagine Europe, but instead cut it from the imperial core, posed a new challenge of Ukrainization and nationalization. And in the 90s, the dominant discourse in the Ukrainian-Russian border was about artificial separation and violent division of a single collective body, about the man-made and temporary character of the border, its political rather than cultural nature. Kharkiv did not like to think itself in terms of a borderland city. And actually, the local intelligentsia was looking back to the fin de siècle Kharkivs, Kharkiv of the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th century, as a dynamic capitalist metropolis, or to the early communist era, the 20s, when Kharkiv was the capital of Soviet Ukraine, and in this capacity it was a center of political and cultural innovations. But the 20s were somehow more controversial in this respect. The real golden age of Kharkiv was the end of the 19th century. This is the house of state industry that you saw during our city tour, an early constructivist piece of architecture, and actually kind of landmark of Kharkiv, something a kind of symbol of Kharkiv. So what is also important to say is another mysterious photo I will explain later. Unlike in Lviv, where this borderlands discourse was a product of local liberal intellectuals, in Kharkiv it was from the very beginning appropriated by the local business and political elites, first of all with the pragmatic aim of legitimizing Ukrainian-Russian cross-border cooperation. And it seems for many in the Kharkiv municipality and regional elites that the cross-border cooperation, if it's not able to heal the wound of the Soviet disintegration, at least it can help to solve some urgent problems and help reestablish broken economic, cultural, and social contacts. And so the instruments of cross-border cooperation, like harmonization of legislation, common infrastructure projects, cooperation in border security issues, Euro regions, they seem to be even more appropriate for the Ukrainian-Russian border because both elites shared like the same mentality, spoke the same language, and moreover, this cross-border cooperation was considered in the 90s as an important pillar of the post-Soviet integration. And already in 1994, the Council of Border Regions of Ukraine and Russia was created, and the next year there was an agreement on cooperation of border regions, which was signed by both governments. And in eastern Ukraine, actually, President Kuchma made this one of his focal points of his symbolic politics, but not only symbolic, of course. And in 2003, the Kharkiv and Belgorod administrations signed an agreement on the Euroregion Slobozhanshchina. You remember Slobozhanshchina is the name of this historical territory, and Slobozhanshchina, I will mention it also later, it has become like Sloboda Ukraine, Slobozhanshchina has become like a symbol of kind of
cultural traditional aspect of this region entirely.
Yeah, and also kind of symbol for cohabitation of Russians and Ukrainians, kind of long historical tradition of living together peacefully and colonizing this territory of Dike Pole, wild field together. So the Euroregion Slobozhanshchina was the first one of the at the Ukrainian-Russian border, and you can see that with this concept of Euroregions, that the imagined Europe was somehow also smuggled in the new Ukrainian-Russian borderlands, but not really as a set of cultural political values or as a geopolitical goal, but more like a rhetoric, political rhetoric, and a set of formal institutions which very much remained formal. So the vision of borderlands that corresponds to these projects of cross-border cooperation resembles a non-differentiated common cultural space, with populations on both sides of the border having like mixed identities. You remember we were talking about mixed identities, hybrid, like Ukrainian-Russian blurred identities, East Slavic or Orthodox or post-Soviet identities. And the local Kharkiv version of this discourse, as I said, refers to Sloboda Ukraine as a historical territory. And the history of Sloboda Ukraine was rediscovered, for example, Dmitro Bagaliy, a Kharkiv historian who in the beginning of 20th century wrote books about history of Kharkiv and history of the region. They were republished, and the emphasis on interpretation of his work was made on the fact that this territory was a territory of joint Ukrainian and Russian colonization, and it was characterized by the absence of ethnic conflict. So this was the strategy of the local elites to kind of renarrate the history of this region. And pragmatism, kind of capitalist spirit, merchant spirit, ethnic tolerance, which replaced like the old Soviet notion of internationalism, but also bilingualism, kind of peaceful coexistence of Ukrainian and Russian culture, they were celebrated by the local elites as a kind of particular characteristics of the local mentality and local identity. And in this discourse, Kharkiv as a historical capital of Sloboda Ukraine, Slobozhanshchina, has to rediscover its identity as a borderland city. But this borderland city was meant not as a fortress, not as a kind of stronghold of Ukraineness on the border, but as a gate to Russia, as a center of the Ukrainian-Russian business cooperation, business relations, initiator of common projects. So you can see also this discourse of multiculturalism, which in Lviv was referring to the positive heritage of the Habsburg Empire. Here, the discourse of multiculturalism was kind of reappropriated old Soviet notion of Soviet internationalism and kind of druzhba narodov and peaceful living together. So on this photo, I made it long time ago in 2004. It's not a good quality. I'm sorry, because it was still made by the normal camera. This was a celebration of the 350 years of Kharkiv, 350th anniversary of Kharkiv. And this was celebrated with a kind of parade in a very much like the 1st of May style, with various like enterprises and factories marching, delegation marching the along the central street. And what you can see here is also kind of wild mixture of images, a new symbol of Kharkiv, which replaced the old Soviet one. And this is, I don't know how it's in English, rock isabilia. So it's like a horn.
Horn of a bundes.
Yes, yeah. And you see also balloons of the color of Ukrainian flag, yellow and blue. And these two blown figures, or two men, seem to symbolize like Ukrainian and Russian faces of Kharkiv. But if we look at the how much time I have? Okay, so if we look at the not so mainstream kind of nationalist discourse in Kharkiv, which of course also existed even before the recent events, this kind of traditional frontier discourse of Ukrainian nationalism. In this discourse, Kharkiv still represents kind of dangerous openness to the East. So you see this kind of idea of openness, which is celebrated here as something positive, openness to Russia, openness to the East. In the Ukrainian frontier nationalist discourse is seen as a weakness, as a kind of weakness of national identity in the borderlands and a threat for the Ukrainian national project. And here also, of course, references have been made to the history of the region. So local Ukrainian nationalists often allude to the traditional image of Kharkiv as a stronghold of Russian influence and a threat for Ukrainian independence. And they argue that Kharkiv was the capital of the criminal communist regime from the 20s to the beginning of the 30s, and until today remains a fortress of the communist oligarchic mafia. So the rule of the communists and the party of regions, somehow there is in their eyes a kind of historical continuity between two regimes. And the communists and the party of regions, in their opinion, were the successors of those who came to Ukraine from Russia after the famine and the post in the post-Soviet decades. And this discourse of Ukraine's eastern borderlands as originally Ukrainian, ethnically homogeneous territory, whose indigenous identity was destroyed by the Soviet regime, is that this is what the core of this old frontier discourse. And it became especially popular after the Orange Revolution, when Kharkiv became kind of hostage of the deteriorating Ukrainian-Russian relations, and the local elites were also deeply split in Kharkiv. Here you see the new, not so new anymore, Holodomor memorial to the victims of the famine in Ukraine, but first of all in the Kharkiv region, which suffered immensely during the famine of 1932-33, and the paradox of the kind of collective memory and politics of memory in this region is that although this region was affected very much by the famine, but there is a kind of among population the idea to remember this disaster as a genocide of the Soviet regime was not really popular, and the Yushchenko government made an effort to introduce this new narrative of the Holodomor as a genocide of Ukrainian people here in Kharkiv, and also kind of punish the local elites which were not cooperating with Kyiv. So similar to Lviv, some intellectuals in Kharkiv have been also developing liberal, critical, or even post-colonial discourses of borderlands, and it could be a subject of interesting research, actually. For example, Serhii Zhadan, well-known now, kind of probably most known in the West, Ukrainian writer, living in Kharkiv, originally from Lugansk region, he tried or still tries to reinvent kind of Eastern Ukraine as borderlands. But of course, to reimagine Kharkiv as borderlands in positive sense, and not to fall into this kind of pro-Russian attitude, and not to fall into kind of Ukrainian nationalist frontier discourse, is something very difficult. So let me give you just one example. In December 2011, Kharkiv National University hosted a panel discussion which was organized and moderated by Lviv historian Yaroslav Hritsak, whom I already mentioned here. And it was provocatively called Borderlands, a Territory of Great Heresies, with question mark. And the discussion was somehow under the auspices of the Czeslaw Milosz year in Ukraine, and with participation of Polish intellectuals. I guess even Adam Michnik was here. And the initiative was somehow, the idea was to kind of introduce the discourse of borderlands and the idea of borderlands in a more post-colonial and post-modern perspective here to Kharkiv, in order to soften somehow these front lines and try to reinvent the region as borderlands in a positive sense. However, this initiative was met with skepticism by the part of the local audience, and Kharkiv philologist Ihar Mikhailov, I think he died last year, he actually summarized this opposition, saying that only strong nation states, which never have faced the problem of preserving their identity, can afford the ideas of total borderlands and multiculturalism. Ukraine, Mikhailin said, was the first European nation to experience what it means to be borderlands, both in the geographical and the cultural sense. Now the goal of Ukrainians is to find themselves, to cease to be borderlands, and finally build a Ukrainian state. So you see, like, kind of local response to this idea is that it's very nice to talk about borderlands as hybrid identities and open space, but if you live here, guys, it feels different. And of course, what happened in Ukraine in 2013-2014 has changed the context of the Ukrainian-Russian borderlands very much. So this is a book of Vladimir Kravchenko, who greeted us on Monday. Kharkiv, the capital of Ukraine, which is the book is in Russian, and it's kind of instructive writing the history of Kharkiv from the this borderlands perspective. And now the last chapter of my talk, and here I will be rather it will be rather fragmented because I'm still kind of trying to arrange this fragmental thoughts in a more sustainable concept. But so we all witnessed that as a result of the Ukrainian-Russian conflict, the borderlands turned into something which can be called rather bloodlands. And here again, we can refer to Tomasz Zaritsky, who was writing that presenting borderlands as a subject with its own agency, the discourse of borderlands tends to ignore power relations and, first of all, geopolitical interests of great powers. And from the nation-building perspective, indeed, as we painfully learned here in Kharkiv, the ambiguity of borderlands is nothing to be celebrated. That the blood and overlapping identities and multiple loyalties can potentially be very dangerous and threaten the integrity of a nation state. And the fact is that the so-called hybrid blurred identities of the Ukrainian-Russian borderlands were instrumentalized by Moscow in an attempt to undermine the territorial integrity of Ukraine. And the population of eastern Ukraine turned to be receptive to such projects as Ruski Mir, Novorossiya, and etc. And we will talk in next week more about borderlands as spaces of nostalgia. And I think here again, in the Ukrainian-Russian borderlands, nostalgia was kind of instrumentalized in this attempt to undermine the integrity of the Ukrainian nation state. And again, this kind of nostalgia is something I often encountered when I was doing interviews here, also in the near border villages some 15 years ago. But what this conflict showed us is that this nostalgia is not something intellectual or ideological, but it's a kind of structural phenomenon, because this nostalgia is also embedded in economic and social hierarchies. And you remember all these talks that pensions are higher in Russia, and that's why Putin prigi, Putin come. This I heard 15 years ago, speaking with people in the near border villages. This was very much this discourse about inequality and economic hierarchies and life being better on the other side of the border. So, using the emotional language of Soviet memory, Russia actually instrumentalized this nostalgia, and it presented itself as an imagined homeland for those in the borderlands, lost in a kind of gray zone of the post-Soviet transition. And in 2014, when Kremlin commentators were speaking about returning to the moment of 1991, the moment of the dissolution of the Soviet Union, kind of reconsidering historical choices and collecting lands again, a million of Ukrainian citizens suddenly became feverish about coming home, as they mistakenly took Putin's Russia for their imagined Soviet homelands. So what we see here, Mir za stenoyu, so peace behind the wall, it's a kind of poster which explains and advertises the idea of the, which was called like the idea of European wall, and it was very popular, was promoted by, at some point, by local Dnipro oligarch Igor Kolomoisky. Later also it was taken up by Prime Minister Yatsenyuk and Poroshenko, the idea that the Ukrainian-Russian border needs to be protected, and it should be kind of security infrastructure which protects Ukraine from illegal migration, from contraband, from smuggling of weapons, and but also stopping like saboteurs entering the Ukrainian territory from Russia. And the rhetoric, so European wall, European rampart, it was like the rhetoric of Ukraine protecting not only itself, but also protecting Europe from kind of savage Russia. And this photo, it's on the central square here in Kharkiv. I don't remember which year it was. Certainly it was like 14 or maybe 15. This is the equipment used to dig the rov, graben. What is the English word for it? So to build the infrastructure at the border, so you have to dig up a kind of
trench,
and this is a machine to dig up this trench, and it was proudly presented at the central square of Kharkiv as a symbol. Like, yeah, it looks also kind of frightening, and so. Symbol of protecting the Ukrainian border. And this is again also some images from the social networks, from Facebook, and you can see that how the popular imagination of the Ukrainian-Russian borderlands has been changing as a result of the conflict. And this border is reimagined as a kind of civilizational rift. Yeah. So I don't know, does not need an explanation here. You see the fighter of the Donbas volunteer battalion in front of the kind of fence. And on the other side of the fence are, I don't know, zombies and orcs and which.
Silent Hill.
Hmm?
Silent Hill.
It's from
Leopard,
from the one.
Yeah.
Post-apocalyptic. Yeah, it's like. I don't want to indulge in this kind of xenophobic Ukrainian discourse about Russians. We have one Russian here, but she is somehow already acquainted with the worst of this discourse and prepared for this. And the second picture shows, it says Russian-Ukrainian border in 50 years. And it's a kind of utopic vision of Ukraine being a Singapore opposed to kind of decaying space, which should be like obviously Russian part of the border. So I will probably stop here. And as you can imagine, I have no conclusion because we are in a situation when we don't know how the conflict is going to be solved and when and if at all. And of course, this very much affects these discourses on borderlands. Here in Kharkiv, nobody talks about cross-border cooperation anymore. It's out of the public debate, of the public space. And Kharkiv, again, so this kind of role, this kind of image, the local elites try to develop Borderlands city like open, a meeting place, a place for business and trade and cooperation, actually failed. And what, how to reinvent Kharkiv again in this situation, being kind of close proximity to the, not only to the Russian border, but also to the conflict in Donbas, it's a big question. I will stop here. Thank you very much.
Lecture, I'm not sure how very related this is to Borderlands, but I still think that is. So you said that there are those two kind of disappointments, like affiliations and disappointments. One is connected with this Eastern direction, and another is with the Western direction, and understanding that Ukraine will not be part of the European Union so soon. But then there is a question, maybe the problem is that there hasn't been offered kind of vision where to move, like ultimate goal, where to go, or how to identify self in like in which part of Europe or world.
But it's difficult to develop this vision in a situation when the city is so close to, as I said, to the border with Russia, but also to the military conflict. And of course, there are some visions and some competing projects and some ideas of how Kharkiv should reinvent itself. And it's also very much like a generational issue, of course. And something which has to be seen and studied is, of course, how, for example, visa-free regime, which was introduced in Ukraine 1 year ago, how it affects like Kharkiv, for example. I don't know if you noticed in the underground, but also on the streets, there is a lot of advertisement, like if you want to learn Polish, and you can also learn Polish and get a Polish working visa, or you can, so companies specialized in providing you with a working visa in Czech Republic. And there are also all kind of initiatives, and I heard from my colleagues at the university that it's very, like Polish destination is very popular now also for Kharkiv students to continue their education, which was not the case before, yeah? So in you can talk about this kind of new tendencies and certainly I would also say that this conflict situation actually kind of gave a kick to the local community and local civil society, because there were a lot of new initiatives, there have been new projects and which were not here before, and we have we never had summer school, like international summer schools in Kharkiv. Why go to Kharkiv? Why go to nowhere? But of course this kind of if you wish, it's also like a, has become attractive for academic tourism, because it's a kind of hub from where you can, if you are doing research on Eastern Ukraine, on Donbas, this is the place from where to go. Yeah. So in a sense, the new situation is, it's not only like cutting old ties, but it also kind of, it's about developing new options, but there is still like no general vision of what the city wants to be, and yeah, I don't want to go into political context of it, but maybe we can talk about it later.
If I may, to say a couple of words, maybe it be influenced.
Could you speak up a little bit?
Maybe my question will be a little bit influenced by those audience with whom I'm normally working. It's teenagers, it's young people. And my assumption is that nowadays we have something like two realities. A classical vision of border and borderlands in terms of physical territory and communities who inhabited those territories. And the second one is rather determined to IT technology and is caused by those crises which we have now, for example, in sociology, because how we recently define what society is. It's a number of communities who historically inhabited particular territory. But take Facebook, for example. Is it community? Yes, it is. To what territory we may define Facebook? Nobody knows. And young people, they build something new, and in terms of border studies, quite interesting where their border is. And my question is, what is your personal estimation to this new approach when some scientists tend to speak about post-territorial world, about inside border, about border in between us, and so on and forth? Because this point of view is rather, I would say, industrial and modern. And what is your personal point of view about these new tendencies, which are rather relevant to young people and well-educated people, as here in audience we may see this international cooperation?
Yeah. Vladimir Maslychuk said in his first lecture that borderlands do not exist anymore because borderlands are everywhere. Yeah, we are all mobile. We are crossing borders all the time. Borders are everywhere, not only national borders, but it's like borders are also virtual. Borders are in social networks. There are communities you borders you don't cross. You kind of you don't communicate with those who post like pro-Russian symbols on their Facebook site. So there is also a border of this kind. Yeah? And this is, I agree, it's a fascinating topic, or maybe not a topic, but an approach to. But I always try to limit myself to a certain understanding of borders, which is somehow, otherwise you cannot study everything. So my interest was and is related to national borders and borderlands in this like more traditional sense, but also we will talk next week a lot about all these issues, how to understand borderlands and borders. But for me personally, it's interesting to trace the developments in the real borderlands, and I mean real in a sense that these are political borders, and the fact that these are borderlands of nation states is very much like, I'm a political scientist, so I'm kind of a political scientist, which is open to other approaches, but still I kind of stick to this particular understanding of borderlands.
If I may add to this, actually, if we are still talking about geopolitics, if we are talking about rise of nationalism, and if it's reflected in social media like Facebook, and actually this new research is done on opinion polls in Eastern Ukraine, which demonstrates that it is reflected on social media so much. So this means that borders are still there, and it's still quite an agenda and quite normal to talk about those borders, and they will not disappear as some pro-globalists say.
Thank you very much for your lecture. I was wondering all the time when you were talking about the phenomenon of social nostalgia on both borders, on both borderlands. And recently I read the latest piece of writing of Hrytsak when he wrote about civilizational mission of Khalichina, actually. And as a representative of Kyiv and not Dniprianchina, I was offended somehow. About civilizational mission of Khalichina. The question I want to put, how do you think, to what extent actually this social nostalgia, both in on western borderlands of Ukraine, this nostalgia for Austro-Hungarian heritage and former Galicia and former multicultural neighborhood, and this Soviet nostalgia here on eastern borderlands of Ukraine, to what extent this nostalgia is maybe reinvented or invented and imposed by local intelligentsia. In western Ukraine, we have Andruhovich, Hrytsak, and other prominent opinion makers, but I don't know actually the specifics here. Whether this nostalgia for Soviet time and Soviet heritage, again, of people living together, united by lingua franca, Russian language, and united by some Soviet values, to what extent it's invented here and maybe imposed here by local intelligentsia? Thank you.
Yeah, complex question, and I cannot answer it in one sentence. So I just, this is something I was thinking also a lot about, comparing Ukrainian, Polish, Ukrainian, Russian borderlands in this respect. So one thing is probably what I want to say first, is most obvious, is that in Lviv, this is a kind of elitist construct. This nostalgia for the Habsburg Empire, I think, is a very much construction for the construction of the local intellectuals, I think. But in the East, it, at least in the beginning, it was like more like a popular sentiment, because it was the separation was so recent, and also because the new border coincided with the kind of temporal boundary, the disintegration of the Soviet Union, and the spatial boundary, separation of Ukraine and Russia. So it gave this strange effect that many people with whom I talked long time ago, like 15 years ago, they were for them, this was these two borders kind of boundaries kind of coincided. Yeah, so they were talking about Russia not as a neighboring country, but like a new version of what was the homelands, like Soviet homelands. And they were looking at Russia as what could happen to us if there would not be this dissolution of the Soviet Union. And that's why I think this is one angle to look at this nostalgia and the effects of the nostalgia. I think Svetlana Boym wrote this book, The Future of Nostalgia, and I did not look into it recently, but I think she kind of identified two types of nostalgia, the reflective nostalgia and restorative nostalgia. And we can also, I'm not ready now kind of apply it directly to both borderlands, but I think these are actually useful concepts to think about the effects of nostalgia in both Kharkiv and Lviv.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid we ran out of time. For now, let's continue with this.